And we can start a little bit first with the theory of what we're going to do. I'm going to describe you the case study, okay? What we're going basically to discuss and provide you with a hands-on experience on a simulation. Okay. We will focus on this case study on indoor exposures. You know, we talked about air pollution, primarily outdoor air pollution, and how this might be, its effects might be modified by climate change manifestations on human health and socioeconomic parameters. So let's focus for now to indoor air, because it's very important. It's an important environmental compartment when you deal with health issues and environmental issues, because people spend most of their time indoors. Yes, more than 90% of our time, if you think about it, you're spending your time inside a closed system. And I'm calling our room here a system because it's composed of many different sections, compartments, that could be sources of exposure or sinks of exposure to parameters that could influence your health. Okay. And these exposure sources and sinks are influenced and modified by the surfaces that are present here, by the materials that are present in the room, okay? By your own individual susceptibility and sensitivity that you have to exposures to indoor pollutants. At the same time, the indoor environment is not fully insulated, right? It's communicates with proper ventilation with the outside world. So you have also an interaction of the external outdoor air pollution with the internal indoor air pollution. And not only that, many times, many systems, the air conditioning, let's say, the ventilation system, or the painted materials that we are sitting on, these have been designed and produced based on some European regulations. So you are experiencing some horizontal and national or supranational regulations that influence now your exposures, okay? So if you are going to study, if you want to do a study on indoor, let's say, air pollution, you have to think also about these things. So you really have to think of a comprehensive study protocol. And you need to put down all the details in order for you to get good answers, proper answers, scientifically based, scientific evidence that you can then go to politicians, you can go to stakeholders, you can go to your boss and say, I'm very proud of what I did, I'm very confident on the outcome of my results. I believe this is a high quality work for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 reasons, and you should read it, and you should use it if you think that it's appropriate. So the better quality is your work, obviously you're leaving less chances to the receptor of that work to be skeptical and to be reserved whether he's gonna take action or not. So they have to respond to you. And the response they will provide you, it will be, of course, dependent on the quality of work you've done. So the more room for arguments that you leave to the stakeholder, it's not good. So you need to maximize somehow the quality of work that you can do, that most of the times it's, as we know, limited by what? What is the most obvious limitation when you design this kind of studies? Anybody? Yeah, money, yeah. It all comes down to money. So there is a very good correlation between the quality of the work that sometimes people do and money. But nevertheless, just because we don't have enough money, that doesn't mean that we cannot produce a cost-effective study protocol. And to maximize the investment, even with the little money that you have, in order to get a good benefit, OK? Okay, so we keep that in mind. So, let me give you the framework that will help you to set up the study protocol, okay? Before we go to the details of that, let me say a few introductory remarks about what we want to do and what's the aim of that case study. The aim of that case study is basically for you to think out of the box and think, though, within a framework like the one I'm sharing you, in order to produce a study plan, a study protocol for a particular setting, indoor setting, and for a particular hypothesis that's going to relate some exposures, let's say, to an outcome. So you will decide that. You will split in three groups. One group will sit this side, two, three, and you will start putting the components of the skeleton of that study plan together based on some guidelines that I'm going to share with you in the next slides. Okay, so you will write down all these things in a computer, in a file. You will be able to back up the selection of your study plan, all the details. We're going to go the details of that later, after that. And you will make a presentation, short presentation, okay? Maximum, let's say, 10 slides. And then your team will come back here and will present the study protocol to the whole cohort, okay? And will receive feedback and questions. So in the end, we're going to listen to three different case studies, basically from you. And you will get feedback from us, from your fellows, colleagues. So that's the objective of that. So I believe this will be a good hands-on training for you. So in order to do this, I'm going to give you some theoretical background for you to consider when you are building your case study. Okay. Let's start from the exposome concept. I discussed a little bit the exposome concept in my lecture a couple of days ago, or yesterday, whenever that was that, I forget. So, the exposome, as we said, is the complete characterization of all the environmental exposures that a person has experienced from the time that he was or she was in his mother's belly to the death. So if somebody can actually collect, capture, and characterize all these exposures throughout one's lifetime, then you can confidently say that I have characterized my exposome, for example, or Eric's exposome. Obviously, this is not an easy task. But this is what people were saying when they started looking into the genome, when they were starting actually characterizing all the genes of and the DNA of the humans. Now we are in a perfectly good condition to characterize anyone's genome. Still very expensive, but we are in a very good position to characterize that. Ideally, we would like to do that also for the exposome. So this is a theoretical framework that we have devised. Actually, this will be published in Stoughton very soon, so this is something very new, that we are trying to extend the concept of that human exposome that I described to you, which is right here. So the human exposome is characterized by these subdivisions, the so-called general external human exposome, so my individual general external exposome, that entails anything that is externally related to me. Okay, that can be some examples. Green space, healthcare facilities, the parks, the streets I'm living in, okay, the climate manifestations, all these are influencing my own human exposome from the general external component. So you need to characterize that. Then we go to the specific external human exposome. So some example of that. Exposures, chemical exposures, microbial exposures that I have. So that means that I'm contacting, they're still external to me, but they're very close to me right now, okay? And they are coming in contact with my body. So this is called specific external human exposome. The lifestyle I'm doing, the occupation I do, all these things are externally to me, but they are influencing my health because they're exposing me to them. And then we have the internal exposome, which is basically the metabolism, the microbiome that I have, the endogenous processes that take place inside my body. So if I characterize all these three different major components, I can say confidently that I have characterized my human exposome. So this has been actually coined by Dr. Weil from IARC at Lyon maybe 12 years ago. So it's a relatively new concept. And we came and we tried to extend the continuum of the human exposome to include the so-called urban exposome, because people not only live most of the time indoors, but also most of the people nowadays live in big cities, as we mentioned also before. So more and more people flock to live in big cities, in mega cities. Why? Because there are more opportunities there, more services, more jobs. It's a better growth for the economies there. So this is the trend of our times. This is particularly true for middle-income and low-income countries, right? So if one wants to provide better healthcare, better environment, better air, better health and climate for our citizens, many people say that maybe you should focus, your setting should be the city, should be the urban environment, because that's where most of the people are. And just because more and more people come into the existing territories of the city, that means that the city is really pressured to provide services for those incoming people. So the number of mega cities is increasing. The area of the cities, because more people coming in, also increases. So you have to build new water pipes. You have to provide people with electricity. So you are thinking about all the scenarios. These are realistic scenarios. So when you're providing this, you are also, depending how good you do that or bad or partially, you are creating some risks for the health of the individuals. Or let me better say it, you are somehow dictating the quality of life that people have in different parts of the city, because you cannot say the air of my city is good. Can you say that? Can you just say the air of Trieste is overall good? Or somebody could think that, okay, maybe the air in the center of Trieste is worse than the area of the air at ICTP by the sea, for example, if you had that evidence. And you see that differentiation of exposures within big cities. You cannot say the water of Bologna is good. Different areas are going to have different quality of water because you have different age of the pipes. The same water comes in, right? But then the infrastructure is aging. And some places of the city, in the old city, the pipes are very old. So the quality of water there might be totally different than areas in good areas, let's say, or in suburbs that are new and they have new pipes. So the urban environment is not homogeneous, it's not uniform. So you really need people, we need to start thinking about that. And already big agencies are thinking about that. So that's why we try to introduce the concept of the urban exposome. In analogy with the human exposome, we have devised also the general external urban exposome in analogy with the general external human exposome, the specific external urban exposome, and the internal urban exposome. But they are different than that of the human exposome. In what sense? So the general external urban exposome is basically what? All the global trends, many of the global trends, whether that's a social trend or a cultural trend, or a policy decision that affects my city, and that comes either nationally or supranationally, like the Sustainable Development Goals, that affects the quality of life in the cities. We know that. Trade agreements, land use issues. So these, oftentimes, they are dictated by big groups, WHO, European Food Safety Agency, FAO. So all these big groups, they are imposing regulations that are impacting the city. So then the city character, because now in the urban exposome, the city is at the core of the definition of the exposome. So like I said before, for the indoor exposome, we described how the European regulations influence and impact the quality of the materials that you are sitting on. So now they ask to put, okay, you're going to put less formaldehyde. You're going to put less toxic materials in the paints. So this comes from oftentimes above and much higher or much farther than the national limits that we have. So Europe is influencing a lot our life. Or international organizations have regulations, and these regulations are imposed on our everyday life. So you need to know what kind of regulations actually take place and influence your city. You need to find out, and you need to see how these regulations actually impact your urban exposome. So that will characterize your general, your city's general external urban exposome. Then you go to the specific external. Here, you talk about what is external to the city. So climate change manifestations, very important. Storms, heat waves, right? Micro heat islands in the city. Or the cultural norms that people have in that particular city. This will dictate the general external urban exposome, and you have to account for that if you want to better characterize your city's quality of life. Then we go to the internal urban exposome that talks about the infrastructure facilities. Okay, what kind of facilities your city have? How friendly is it to the citizen? Because that will also influence his or her health. Do you have sidewalks? Do you have parks? Do you have bicycle lanes for people to be physically active? Do you provide them access to the sea? Do you give them transportation that is friendly? These are the so-called internal, because now these are part of the city. And in this way, you have characterized the urban exposome. And this comes in analogy, and you need to complement this urban exposome with the human exposome. If you do that, you're going to have a much better picture of how perhaps you can influence the quality of life in your citizens, and how perhaps you can reduce some of the health risks that are anticipated. You go beyond the philosophy, okay, I'm going to look at PM2.5 and I'm going to connect it with all-cause mortality. You are looking at much more parameters that might influence the all-cause mortality. So these issues actually are done in different levels, as you can see, both in time. You can do this in time, right? You can either do it retrospectively, meaning you can use some of the collected information in the past from different regulatory bodies, let's say from the water authorities, from the air authorities. They have time data, for sure. And some of them have also good space data. So they might give you information about different areas of your city or what is your setting. So this is also very important, because space and time are extremely important parameters for you to characterize the exposures in your population. And it's often very difficult, but if you have a good catch of the spatiotemporal variability in your system, then you can really explain lots of the variability in many of the parameters you are after. So these are like an umbrella, right? So you can either have information on individuals. So we talk about a very good resolution unit and the household, let's say. So I know the coordinates of the household. I know where it is. I can use GIS to actually map these individuals. I can map these households on a map. And I can see spatially then how the exposures for that individual or for that house show up in the map. That can be really useful. Or the unit of resolution can be neighborhoods. Somehow the cities are divided in quarters, in some smaller divisions, in zip codes. Maybe you have information at that level. Typically you don't. In many cities you don't have this kind of information, okay? Or it's very difficult to collect. You really need to go and dig into files by yourself or by your team from the municipality or for the authorities to actually merge the files and have a good picture of what's going on in your population of interest in the city. What is more common is maybe to have some kind of aggregate data at the city level, right? So we have some information about air pollution from a few monitoring stations, 2-3 monitoring stations around the city. And that usually goes for many years back. This is a more common resolution of information, okay? So to wrap up, we have the component that you have to look into on the drivers that will influence the relation between the exposures that you are after with the outcome, and you have to consider the resolution that you are dealing with, the information, at both spatial and temporal resolution. So you need to define how far spatially, geographically, am I going to cover in my study? How far in time should I go back or forward to study my population? These are very important parameters you have to think of, right? And you have to think of all those parameters in order to have a good system representation, a systems approach, how they call it. So if you work in a regulatory authority, if you work in a municipality, or if you work in a research institute, you know, you need to really put down all this information in order to build a better study plan for whatever you want to answer, whatever the question is. Okay. So, let me see. Yeah. Let me go a little bit now more specific to the environment, because I gave you the general, let's say, framework of the overall human exposome and the overall urban exposome. But as we said, we're going to focus on indoor exposures. So let's see a little bit how does the indoor exposome would look like. This is just a paradigm or an example of the indoor exposome and what people should think about. So let's say you have studied, you want to study the setting in your own home. So you really have to think, what are the major air, let's say, components that are now in my home? Because now we are living in complicated systems, right? Many times we don't know the materials. We don't know what's, many people don't know the materials that their own home is made of. They don't know what kind of ingredients, the surfaces, the air conditioners, or whatever appliances we have in our home. And therefore, if you don't know the composition of these materials, you don't really know what you're exposed to. The easiest thing would be to live in the ancient world, where, you know, most people were living outside, basically, or in a cave. You had an ambient atmosphere, natural. You had very little risks that were coming from an indoor environment. Okay, you had other kinds of risks back then. And presently, what do you have? That's a conventional house, let's say, that somehow the red dots are, let's say, risky elements, risky exposures, and the green one are, let's say, non-risky or less risky components. So you need to consider, you know, exposures that come from the window, from the ventilation, the AC, from the appliances that you have. And ideally, you want to characterize all the air, all the water, all the surfaces that you have in your system, in your house, or whatever indoor system in order to know what are the risks to your health. You cannot just say, I'm going to study PM10 and see the asthma prevalence in a number of houses in the city of Trieste as I'm going to follow them up for the next 10 years. You should really nowadays, because you have the knowledge, you should really start considering also other aspects of the exposome, because these little details can help you to better characterize the exposures. You're going to reduce somehow the uncertainty and the variability in these exposures. So if you do that, if you have a much better estimate of exposures with little variance, then this means automatically that you're going to have better estimates of your outcome. They're going to be more robust. They're going to be less unstable. You're going to introduce less bias in the characterization of your outcome. So the answer to your question will be stronger. So you have to think about all these components. What are the air threats, the air stressors, okay? What are the inside the house, the water stressors? What are the surfaces that could either act as sources or as sinks, right? And we have some examples here, as you can see. These examples of stressors can range from particles, okay? These are disinfection byproducts. We are chlorinating, we are disinfecting, we are cleaning the house, right? The surfaces, the floors. We use disinfectants. So these disinfectants, they emit some chemicals, the so-called disinfection byproducts, these ones. Or lead. Maybe lead is in some paints. Maybe it's in the wall, right? Some microbes. Maybe you have some mold on the walls. So how do you deal with this mold? Is that influencing your health? Does this mold emit some biotoxins that could be really bad? Or you go and you take a shower. If your water is stagnant, maybe you are at risk of contacting Legionella. You have to check all these possible sources that might undermine your health. Or maybe you are exposed to trace metals from different surfaces or from water that you drink. Many questions, but you really have to answer these questions when you draft a study plan. Okay, so we go to the study protocol. These are some, not all. You can think of some others possibly, and you should include them in your presentation of how you are going to make a presentation about what? You're going to select the setting. What will be your indoor setting? You're going to have three teams, so you will choose, each team is going to choose their own setting, indoor. Okay? Then, you will have to characterize all the components of the human exposome and the indoor exposome that we discussed here. By what? By mentioning what is the population of interest. Kids, adults, people with compromise, maybe you study a hospital, right? Maybe you study a geriatric unit. The characteristics of the population. I'll leave it up to you. You can put any population you can think of, right? And then you're gonna formulate your hypothesis. What is the research question? What you're trying to answer? What are the objectives of this study, right? And then you can start thinking about the components of the exposome. You're gonna start thinking about horizontal, like climate change drivers. You're gonna talk about, let's say, the stressor receptor model. We described, and others also talked about this in the air pollution exposure by Keyes. He was talking about the stressor receptor model, meaning what is the stressor, the exposure, and the receptor, the human being. So you have to define there all the sources in your system. What are the major sources? What are the major sinks that you might have also in your system? What is the outcome of interest? If you want, you can put an outcome. Maybe you don't want to put an outcome. You just want to characterize the exposures. That's fine for the teams also, right? The methods you will follow to measure the exposures. The same for the outcomes, and also very important, I want you to consider at least one control option. So when you eventually say, okay, I'm going to study this and that with this way, this is a study plan, ideally you will also like to have an alternative. Always, when we highlight a problem, we always come up with a proposed solution, always. Otherwise, you're doing half the job. Okay, any questions? Yes.
The horizontal challenges. What is vertical challenges? That's first. At second, stressor receptor modeling. I my knowledge, I know more receptor modeling. What means stressor receptor modeling?
What is the stressor receptor model? It's basically considered as stressor is anything that stresses me, puts a burden on me, on my health, on my quality of life. So it can be any exposure. Let me put it simply this way. So you're going to look into exposure and outcome. So the receptor is a human being in that case. Okay, so you want to see how the stressors, different environmental exposures, indoor, influence my health. So ideally you could have, you know, you can draw ideally in your PowerPoint, make the indoor setting and put there the different sources that can help you to visualize better all the possibilities that you have for exposures. Right? Did I answer?
Challenges.
I mentioned some about the horizontal drivers. Is that what you're referring to?
Yes.
Horizontal drivers is basically any variable like the climate change manifestations that influences many different sectors. So it's horizontal. So it's affecting many different sectors. It can affect transport, energy, health, economy, social aspects. So climate change manifestations influences all these sectors. So climate change is basically a horizontal challenge. It's a driver that influences many systems of our society. That's what it's meant. Any other questions about what we... Did you understand what we have to do? I mean, okay, we... Yes. We are here. We can answer our questions also closer.
Can you repeat a little bit what you mean about control option? You mean a way to reduce the exposure or to have a control that we consider not exposed versus our case study?
Control option will be, okay, you will identify, let's say, through your study, it's a simulation, right? So you should mention 1, 2, 3 exposure sources and related routes of exposure are causing me a serious harm, serious risk. So how can I reduce that risk? In order to reduce the risk, what do we have to reduce? Always. If you want to reduce the risk, you are reducing exposures. Always the case. So I want to reduce the risk of a disease of actually developing type 2 diabetes. I have to look into the major risk factors of that disease and then try to reduce the magnitude of exposure to that risk factor, right? So we can propose some engineering solutions, right? Maybe you can propose some educational campaigns that can influence the behavior of the people that live in the house to reduce their exposures. Maybe people are cooking inside the house with solid fuels of really bad quality and they're emitting particles and other components that are really bad for the health. Yes?
We know that in radioactive exposure, if we eliminate the exposure, the risk is exist. But in the pollution impact, if we eliminate, you have said that if we eliminate exposure, we eliminate the risk. It is true.
Yes. If you reduce the exposures, you are reducing the risk. Yes.
There is not stochastic risk in this case.
Okay, probabilistic risk, yes. You have, let's say, for example, probability of 1 in 1,000 to actually develop cancer due to exposure to arsenic. Okay, so that's a probabilistic risk statement. So there are, based on the dose response, you know that for each increase, let's say, in 1 unit of exposure to arsenic, I'm having also an increase in risk 10%. Something similar to the exercise we did yesterday. So you know the relationship between exposure, the dose, and the response. So then, if you want to lower the response, the risk, you're playing with exposure. So you're reducing the exposure, you're going to reduce also the risk of the disease. Yes, he's giving the microphone, yes. And then the lady, I can hear you.
Please, I hope to know how can I decide that the result of risk is due to indoor exposure, not outdoor.
You have to study both somehow and compare.
Wait. How?
Right? When you talk about indoor also communicates with the windows, with the doors, because, with... Right?
I'm sorry. For some sample of population, for any person, this one person exposed to indoor pollution, also to outdoor pollution. How can you determine the diseases of mortality is due to exact indoor, not outdoor?
There are some analytes, some chemicals, let's say, or some stressors that are appearing both indoor and outdoor, meaning the sources can be also both ways. Okay, so let's say this is very true for some secondary aerosols and ozone. Recently, there was a very new recent paper in Science, I believe, that showed that many of the emissions, air emissions, that we were considering mostly to come from vehicles, from transport, we see that they may be also coming to an equal contribution from materials you use inside the home, like cleaning products, like personal care products, sprays, etc. So this is really breaking news, because so far we're trying to reduce somehow the emissions from transport, from the transport sector, from vehicles, etc. And now we see that most of the, let's say, greenhouse gas levels in the atmosphere come also from indoor exposures due to the systematic use of cleaning products, of sprays, of personal care products. So that means you have to study both systems. Eh? Somehow you're going to focus, let's say, on ozone. Measure ozone inside the house and measure also ozone outside. The lady from Indonesia wanted to ask a question. Yes.
I have two questions. And you said that we should consider all the parameters inside the house as indoor pollution, as indoor pollution assessment. Do you also consider the like radioactive exposure, like radon, because some material in some house exposes the radon?
Very, very and good question.
The second one is about occupational exposure. Most of people working in certain job realize that their job has a risk for certain exposure. Then what do you think about that? Thank you.
Okay. Both of them very good questions. I see you are all asking very relevant questions, so it looks like that we are in a good track. So regarding the first question, which was about radon, yes. So as you saw yesterday in the presentation, where they were actually conducting this source apportionment to see which of the major air pollutants contribute most to mortality or to morbidity, you saw that radon had a really high percent contribution to mortality, morbidity, burden of disease. Why? Because radon comes from where? From rocks, right? It's a natural radioactive material that is present naturally. So that's why many basements, house basements, that's another indoor environment of interest. You know, people like to build basements, but this basement, if it's in contact with rocks that emit radon, and this basement is not well ventilated or aerated, then people that are present in that basement, depending on the time and the duration and the magnitude of the exposure, are going to be at risk of developing, let's say, lung cancer, because radon is a known carcinogen, particularly for lung cancer. So that's another indoor environment that you really need to think of And the second about occupational exposures. That's another interesting, very interesting environment, factory. You are a worker, but it depends what kind of activities, what's your job type. I'm working in a factory, but I'm basically an accountant. So I'm not really involved with factory emissions. But if I'm a worker, then I'm having exposure, occupational exposure, oftentimes higher than ambient or household exposures. And that's why most of these exposure assessment protocols, they started in industrial hygiene, they started in factories, where employers wanted to learn more why their workers were getting sick. And the employers were losing money in that sense, because they had to pay for the workers' cost, healthcare costs. They were losing days from work, which translates into loss of money for the employers, for the boss, right? So companies that have a vision, big companies, they think about these issues now. So they monitor many times the exposures, occupational exposures of the workers. So if I'm doing, let's say, a particular type of work that is exposing me, let's say, to chromium, to high concentration of chromium, maybe I can rotate this worker. So I have him for a month, and then I move him to another job type, and then he does something that will reduce his exposure to chromium. In order overall, during a year, you have an overall cumulative exposure that is below the safety limit. So you have to think also, yes, about these issues.
I have a question also related to radon. If we have reference that the country is not really, or we don't have existing radon in the soil or in the country, do we have to measure for it? Do we have to measure it in the protocol? Let's say we're conducting a study on indoor environment and we're evaluating the health effects. Do we have to measure radon if we have reference that say that the country is not, we do not have radon, let's say, or we have trace of radon?
You should, yes. You should try to be as inclusive as possible regarding, and transparent regarding the tools you use, right? The information you use, from where did you collect it? How applicable can you do that portability issue that Francesco was mentioning before?
Where we're conducting the study, let's say, we have reference that there is no radon in general in the country. So we have to measure it.
Yes, sure, sure. Even those negative, nowadays, you know, even if you get negative results from a study, this is also very important because it can really tell you, okay, there is no risk if the negative results were implying no risk. And this is also very important and you need to publish. So now many journals are also considering publishing even negative results in the sense that you really did not reject the initial hypothesis that you had. You were not able to reject the null hypothesis. So this is fine, yeah. Any other? Okay, so we should split, how many we are? 2, 4, 7, 8, 10, 12, 14, 17, 19, 21, 22, 23, 24. So 8 people. So 8 people this row, 8 people that row, and 8 people in that row. Come on, guys, let's do it. Enough time, let's start first by 20, let's say half an hour maximum, in order to design, to think about it, and make a few slides, because then you have to present it also. So 10 minutes presentation, so maximum 10 slides. Thank you. good idea. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So we have 5 minutes left, huh, before the presentations, okay? And the best will win a grant for conducting the study.
Guys, we should finish in 5-10 minutes maximum. The presentation skeleton ideally should follow this pattern, okay? So have one slide intro, one slide hypothesis and objective, 3 slides approximately methods, 4 slides results, 1 slide comments, okay, maximum. So it looks like that we are wrapping up. We have already one group that finished. I'm going to invite them to come to the podium to make the presentation. We also have other two groups almost done, and we're waiting on the fourth group. Initially, we had three groups, but we had some kind of a cell division, so we ended up with four groups. There was a lot of debate, I guess, so that's good. Debate is always good. Yes. So group one, please.
This is the name of the groups, right? We don't need to blah blah blah, just the name of the groups.
No, I think we should stay in the name.
Say, Hannah, Ramis, Koma?
Kumpa.
Kumpa. Kumpa. I think everyone, he said his name. Maybe better.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes,
it is there.
It's there.
We call it a group.
Maybe this is another one.
No, I think
it's with Paul.
Okay, so copy for him.
Yeah,
give it to him. Copy.
Okay.
Already, I think I gave.
No, this is another one. Not same.
Ah, the others are not ready, so we could have continued. You are stressing us.
I think that he also wanted us to kickstart it so that it would put some pressure. Time is running out.
I heard.
We will give another copy.
There are two files to get.
I present it here.
Okay.
And the fourth one.
You are presenting first two, right? This is presenting third one.
Third one.
Okay.
Third one.
And after
and four,
third and fourth, because the fourth is so small. Add third and fourth. Do three.
How many slides do we have?
Ten.
Oh, which one is?
Hannah. Group Hannah.
The first
group Hannah.
The first
yeah.
one. Yes.
Let check. I will present. All of the others. I will present. Just two or two and three.
Okay. Oh, let's
just I have another one. Yes.
But you see, look at
this
that.
This is just one line.
Yeah, Jones, one line, one line. It's a matter of saying something. If,
maybe
yeah,
I will give the introduction.
You come in with a setting.
Come
yes, with the,
to this.
The text
the
line.
Setting.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then some references.
This is just one line.
Yeah,
maybe you can
okay,
do
and
that.
Then
maybe
hypothesis and objective.
You can continue.
So it should be the most recent
three
one.
Slide. One line. And then Mr.
Yeah.
Lab said
no, no, it's case study.
And maybe the last.
Okay, the
nine,
alpha, control.
10.
Okay?
Okay.
Yes.
Konstantinos.
This was here.
Yeah, it was here.
Okay. Okay. Oh, there is true group. Oh, no.
Yes.
Okay. Which one I open?
Anna.
Anna, yeah.
Yes.
It is open. No, we're just
the plane.
No, but they can't say 5 minutes. So we
can still do it, yes, not late.
I want to write something, right?
Strong group.
Modern house is not.
That's a problem. That's a problem with so-called modern house. Now it's developing in Ghana
fair.
Where you have.
Yeah, we are ready. No problem. Please.
How many minutes?
Start.
5 minutes or 2 minutes or how many minutes? Five?
Say 5 minutes.
Okay.
This one, and then you
just,
come in again.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Hello, everyone. Yes, this is the name of our group members. I'm Hannah.
Then?
I am Ramiz.
Kwame.
I am Komkwa.
And I'm Biplop.
Good afternoon, everyone. In the introduction, air pollution, both in short-term as well as long-term, affect our health. Indoor pollution is much more important than the outdoor pollution, as we are spending more time of our life in indoor condition. We need to take proper care about the indoor environment.
Our setting is ground floor apartment with two rooms and kitchen. Exposed population in the family, 4 persons including 1 infant and 1 child and 2 adults. Indoor environment is not affected with camping climate and we have air conditioned machine.
So this brings us to our next slide, which talks about the receptors. So the receptors in the case of our study will be the family members, including children who live in the apartment. Hypothesis, what we are saying is that the indoor setting or the indoor environment has more pollutants than the outdoor setting. And we want to seek to check whether this hypothesis is true or not. And so the objective will be to estimate and reduce the indoor pollution.
And here we have identified the name and types of pollutants. We may have ozone, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, radon, maybe VOC, semi-VOC, PVC, and many more as indoor pollutants. And the major sources of these pollutants, and we have having this radon and other gaseous pollutants, they are coming from natural environment. Just we are listening, maybe the rock bed is giving us this kind of gases. We have particulate matter, PM2.5, PM1, of course PM10 also. Those are coming from kitchens, coming from our floor mattresses. We have organic compounds in our house in indoor conditions. Those may come from paints, and we have many plastic items in our room. Those also gives us the semi-volatile organic carbons. Those are also pollutants. And of course, we are having micro and macro organisms, and those comes from many, many items in our home, present in our home, as well as maybe our books, our pets, and of course, we ourselves are responsible for many macro and micro organisms. So, I think it is your turn. Huh?
Yes. Okay, so after listing all those stressors, now how to control them? We have carpet, floor mattress, we should remove them. We have also to improve cooking system in the house from fossil fuel to induction. And also non-hazardous chemicals from room and furniture paint. He said about paint. And also what we can do is to use an alternative chemicals for fire resistance items. And we can also clean and replace the pipe water and have, why not, proper ventilation. So we said we have a stressor and we have a receptor. So who is the receptor? Or what is the receptor? The receptor is me, is you, is the family member. So it means that the diseases are going to occur. So which kind of diseases? First, respiratory diseases like asthma, like all other respiratory diseases. We can also have heart diseases, cardiovascular diseases. And also, if it's a long term, we can have lung cancer. We can have, a retarded group. We can have also a premature birth with, as we say, we saw yesterday, a low weight. And also we can have other diseases such as Alzheimer, Parkinson. And of course, in the indoor, we can have skin contact. So we can have also eczema. And as we saw today, when those people are sick, they're gonna go to the hospital. It's a matter of losing money. So thank you very much. It's what we wanted to show you. We within 5 minutes. Thank you.
Excellent. In 5 minutes, congratulations. Just maybe a few suggestions in terminology. When you say control, please maybe use prevention, because it's, you know, a little bit more technical. And also, when you, these ideas, because now they are just thoughts, they can be improved in a formal protocol. So for example, for outcomes, it's better to divide short, acute, and chronic, not a mixture, otherwise will be. And also, it's a good idea to include in the protocol outcomes that you are sure you can measure. And the same with exposure. When you talk about, you know, the excellent review of all the pollutants from where they are from and the prevention measure, but how can we measure the level of indoor pollution? So, and you can find in the literature review everything you need. And it's good also to have a look at the family members, of course, because you have indoor, but maybe at the most susceptible one, children and older. Because also, especially the people, older people, they spent more time indoor than the other, and very good for the proper ventilation, because sometimes if you use water to clean and you open the window, you can do a dramatic improvement in the public health on the village. But thank you so much. Excellent, really.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hello? Okay. Very good work indeed, because we gave you so little time to work on it, less than half an hour, and you prepared something very nice, because you try to capture, let's say, the skeleton of the approach ideally you like to work on. And this is something like, you know, like a take-home thing, something to build up on it. You know, you can go back to your country and you can start building up on it. You have like a first draft, you can make it more details, you can add more information, right? And you came up, you presented nicely, you had a nice posture, enthusiasm. You describe the elements of the presentation, intro, objectives, methods, results. Very important also to be able to communicate your results to the audience in a proper way. So thank you. Thank you again. Very nice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
To finish the session, because we will have this round table, but we want the other groups to present. We can do it tomorrow morning. If you started to create your slides, your PPT, okay? So homework for you. We can find rooms tomorrow morning for each of the other groups to present the same way, more or less. It's okay for you guys? Okay, thank you.
Presentation is tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is our work?
Okay. Oh, which one open? This one?
I think we are going to stop, so it will be shown tomorrow morning, as I understand.
All the presentations.
It's okay.
Tomorrow.
All the presentations tomorrow?
Because it's break.
Okay.
So we should say it's break time. We will continue working on it.
Up to you. So it's you can take it back?
Okay, 1 second.
So guys, let's break for 10 minutes or so, and the next presentations will take place tomorrow, so that we don't deviate from the program. Okay? Let's take a break. You have some more time to work on your presentation, and you will do those presentations tomorrow morning.